This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning to you, and today my class is mainly on the one of the very important complication of acute diarrheal diseases and dysentery. So just I want to know how many of you know about that, what are the complications are consequences of acute diarrheal diseases are dysentery. Can anybody list out the complications of acute diarrheal diseases? What are the complications if you treat properly, not treated properly of a child with acute diarrheal diseases? Devendra, I think this is Devendra's batch only, no? Devendra is there? Amulika. Present. You have to answer in between, otherwise I think that all of you are sleeping.
Present, ma'am.
Kamalika, who is there?
Yes, ma'am. Kamalika, ma'am.
Just to list, tell some complications of acute diarrheal diseases. I think you already finished your microbiology, pathology, all those several SPM. Huh? Is it correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Then you have to think about something. You have to ask the midway of MBBS course. Finished your pathology and microbiology is very important topic. So you subject you finish means you will be knowing something related to the pathology and etiology of diseases. So just think and tell few complications of acute diarrheal diseases and dysentery. Anybody? Not only Kamalika, or anybody voluntarily can answer.
Dehydration, ma'am.
Dehydration, good. It's very, very important thing. Dehydration.
Hypovolemia.
Anything else?
Hypovolemia.
Hypovolemia. Okay, hypovolemia. So dehydration not treated initially, it will goes to hypovolemia. Dehydration further, severity will leads to hypovolemia. Hypovolemic shock actually, hypovolemic shock. What happens if you won't treat hypovolemic shock to the child?
It could lead to coma.
Okay, dehydration not treated, it will go to hypovolemic shock. What happens if hypovolemia is not treated? What happens if hypovolemic shock, that is decreased blood volume
circulation? Patient goes into shock, coma.
Circulation to that?
Cerebral decrease.
That's end stage. For that, hypovolemic shock leads to decreased GF and renal failure, leading to renal failure and cardiac failure and death. That's all. Dehydration, yep. And hypovolemic shock. Anything else? Anybody? Roll number 10. Who is roll number 10? Roll number 10 absent. Huh? Is roll number 10 is there in the class or not?
Present, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Name, I want your name.
Anudya, ma'am.
Okay. So what are the other complications you told below?
Renal failure.
Be loud and clear. I am able to hear you.
Renal failure.
Okay. Acute renal failure or acute kidney injury. Anything else?
What infection. Electrolyte disturbances.
Dyslipidemia or electrolyte disturbances. Most commonly affected electrolytes in diarrheal diseases are? Which are electrolytes will be disturbed?
Sodium, potassium, chlorine.
Sodium and potassium. So, chlorine. So, they may go for hypo or hypernatremia or hypo or hyperkalemia and hyperkalemia is most common, not hypo, but sodium, it may be hyponatremia or hypernatremia. Hypo means decreased sodium levels in the blood. Hyper means high levels. I think you know by this time. And hyperkalemia, increased potassium levels, serum potassium levels, more than 5.5 like that. Hyperkalemia and hypokalemia also, both. Initially, it will be hypokalemia. If the child goes for the acute renal failure, he will have hyperkalemia and hyperuremia. So, electrolyte, dyselectrolytemia, electrolyte dysfunctions also. one of the common complications of acute diarrheal diseases are dysentery. Anything else? Roll number 15. Roll number 15. If you won't answer, I'll think that at least say yes, you are there or not. Otherwise, I think I will mark as a absent. Roll number 15, 15. Absent, 15 roll number. Next 16. Roll number 16. Who's roll number one? Roll number one.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Anybody? Roll number one or 16? Yes, ma'am.
Roll number one, ma'am.
Just mention some of the complications of acute Okay. Tell me some complications. She already mentioned some, no? So other complications of acute diarrheal diseases are dysentery. Any roll number? Your one. What is your name?
Sandhya, ma'am.
Sandhya. Can you mention any complications of acute diarrheal diseases?
Hypovolemia.
Already she mentioned, no. Tell other complications. Hypovolemia already discussed. Okay. Anybody from the seventh semester? Anybody complications of acute diarrheal diseases or dysentery?
Shock, ma'am.
Below.
Shock, ma'am.
In clinics also we discussed, I think, during our clinical postings also we discussed about the complications of acute diarrheal diseases. Devendra is there? Devendra. I think your batch, right? Devendra is in your batch only. Devendra present or absent? I want to know. Okay, Sumana? Sumana is present? Okay, if you are not able to answer, I will list out the complications or consequences of acute diarrheal disease or dysentery. Before that, you should know what is the definition of diarrheal disease. When do you call diarrhea? Anybody? Seventh semester students, tell me what do you mean by diarrhea? When do you call diarrhea? Or otherwise, definition of diarrhea. So any change, recent change in the frequency or consistency of the stools passed by a child is called as diarrhea. So it depends upon the frequency and consistency, recent change. In adults, we can say more than 3 new stools per day is called as diarrhea. But in pediatrics, we can't take same definition as consideration because it varies with the age of the child. Like in case of newborns, they may pass around 8 to 10 times per day. That's normal. It's not called as diarrhea like that. So recent change in the consistency or frequency, like child used to pass, newborn used to pass 8 to 10 times per day. Now he's passing 15 to 20 times per day. That is a diarrhea. The child used to pass 2 times or 3 times per day regularly, like infant, toddlers, they will pass around 2 to 3 times per day. That is normal for them. If they are passing 5 to 6 times, so recent change in the frequency are consistent. They used to pass semi-solids. Now it's loose. Like that also we can consider. So recent change in the consistency and frequency of stools are otherwise more than 3 loose stools per day called as diarrhea. What do you mean by acute diarrhea? Acute diarrhea means onset will be less than 14 days. Chronic diarrhea means more than 14 days. Chronic diarrhea we call as chronic diarrhea. Acute diarrhea usually lasting for less than 14 days. But there is a another entity called persistent diarrhea. If the onset is acute, but it's not subsided and it is there beyond 14 days, we call this persistent diarrhea. Usually it will be infective origin. So acute diarrhea and persistent diarrhea usually infective on origin, but chronic diarrhea is a non-infective, usually due to malabsorptions. What is meant by dysentery? So acute diarrhea is usually loose watery stools. So change in the frequency or consistency, but dysentery means there is a frank visible blood in the stool. that is called as dysentery. So there is a presence of frank blood in the stool, always it is called as dysentery, but usually it may be associated with pain, abdomen, tiny smells and all those things also. Usually they will pass small frequent stools with blood and mucus in the stools. So complications or consequences of clotted area, as already discussed, is a dehydration, and if it is not treated, it will go for hypovolemia and hypovolemic shock and renal failure. And other complications are metabolic acidosis, potassium depletion leading to hypokalemia, sodium disturbances leading to hypernatremia, and encephalitis, because most of the acute days are viral in etiology. Same virus can cause encephalitis. Encephalitis means inflammation of the inflammation and infection of the encephalon. So it associated with both features of altered sensorium and also seizures. And HUS, what is HUS? Anybody can mention? What is the full form of HUS?
Hemolytic uremic syndrome.
Hemolytic uremic. And meningitis, one more CNS complication of acute diarrheal diseases and dysentery is the meningitis. And there will be metabolic disturbances like hypoglycemia, because diarrheal losses will be more, and on the top of that, parents won't give the food, sufficient food to the child, so they may go for hypoglycemia, and that can cause seizures. And meningitis also, they only have seizures. And the age of the child is between 6 months to 5 years of age. Because of fever itself, without CNS involvement like meningitis or encephalitis, the child may have seizures. That is called as febrile seizures. Usually, high temperature leads to seizures in this case. And cerebral venous and sagittal sinus thrombosis, because of hypovolemia. Hypovolemia leads to increased viscosity of the blood. So sluggishness and flow in the flow of the blood while passing through the small capillaries and venules, leading to cerebral venous sinus and sagittal sinus thrombosis. So this can manifest with hemiplegia and monoplegia like focal neurological deficit. So these are the complications of today, because among consequences of clotted diarrhea and dysentery. Among these complications, because it can affect the not only brain, it affects the renal system and GIT also. The child may go for renal failure, and sometimes they may go for end-stage renal disease, and they may need renal transplantation. For that purpose, you should know what is hemolytic uremic syndrome. How many types are there, how to identify this condition, and how to treat and how to prevent also. Now, these are my learning objectives of this class, today's class. So it's a hemolytic uremic syndrome is a heterogeneous, it's not a single disease. It's a heterogeneous group of disorders that are common acute kidney injury in children. AKA, because acute renal failure is now replaced by the term acute kidney injury. So it's one of the common cause of acute kidney injury in children, followed by, usually there will be preceded by, there will be history of prodromal history of some diarrhea, dysentery will be there, minor infections. So this is, these are usually characterized by microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia, and acute renal insufficiency. Actually, this is for your PG quiz, UG quiz also. Usually we will have Indian Academy of Pediatrics undergraduate quiz every year. For that also, they will ask what is the triad of hemolytic uremic syndrome. You should remember microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia, and acute renal insufficiency is the triad of hemolytic uremic syndrome. And there are mainly two groups. One is the classical type, that is usually associated with Shiga toxin associated hemolytic, common in young children. I think Ewing syndrome. That's a common type, and recently only finished over microbiology. You know that how many types of Fusarella are there? Types. Shiga toxin associated HUS, that's a classical type, common in. There are four types of Shigella. Shigella dysentery, Shigella. Anybody is able to answer? So among the Shigella dysentery is the one which produces a Shiga toxin, and that is associated with the hemolytic uremic syndrome. And atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome is there. This is uncommon. rare presentation, but it can affect any age of children. It is also common in adults also, a typical HVS, but in pediatric case group, any age can be affected. And usually it is associated with abnormalities of complement pathway, alternative complement pathway, abnormalities of alternative pathways of complements. That's why prognosis is also poor in a typical HVS. Here there won't be any cigatoxin associated hemolytic anemia. So main cause, common causative organisms are E. coli, that too, neurotoxin producing E. coli and Shigella dysentery 1. These are the most common etiological organisms associated with cigatoxin associated hemolytic uremic syndrome. But there are other causes like streptococcus pneumonia also can cause, but they're rarely associated. Among this you have to remember, it may be asked in the orals and also for your UGPs and also PG entrance. After your MBBS, you have to appear for the PG entrance. So this is the entrance bit. You have to remember this value. This is the type virotoxin producing E. coli, O157H7. This is 10 type and 1104H4. You can remember 157H7 and 104H4. That is virotoxin producing E. coli serotypes, which are associated with the hemolytic uremic syndrome. And Shigella types, Shigella dysentery 1, it's more commonly, especially in South Asian region, and usually causes diarrhea problem preceding the hemolytic uremic syndrome. These are the two commonest organisms which are associated with classical type of hemolytic uremic syndrome. Coming to the pathogenesis, usually titles are immediate injury to the endothelium in the renal microvasculature leads to localized proliferation and fibrin deposit. And so mainly microvasculature is affected. Red cells also deranged and shapes is also abnormal. So because of damage. So yes, red cells and platelets are traverse these microvasculature. They are injured and sequestered. The capillaries of the glomerulus, so they will be affected, leading to renal necrosis and renal failure, and other organs like brain and also GIT also affected by this microvascular abnormalities and damaged RBC. So when the RBC's normal shape is lost, so deformability of the RBC will be lost. So they will more clog and sluggish full of the blood will take place and leads to microthrombi formation. This is the main pathogenesis of hemolytic uremic syndrome. Here you can observe, whenever the child or the person eats some meat or some non-vegetarian food, especially uncooked or partially cooked, there are more chances of infection and release of this toxin, sugar toxin. So these toxins in the intestines will bind and produce a bloody diarrhea, dysentery. And one more thing, what is NUU5G? This is sialic acid. This sialic acid is present in the this N-glycoryl neuronic acid. This is a sialic acid. It's present in non-human mammals. It is not present in the humans, but other mammals will have this sialic acid. Whenever this meat will be eaten partially cooked and not hygienically prepared, this sialic acid, which is present in the meat, will enter into the and accumulate. This is not digested by the human body. So accumulated in the intestinal epithelium, this leads to toxin production and binding. So this is the one more mechanism which creates the immune system and cytotoxin release in the intestines and also in the epithelium. This acid will be accumulated. That's a typical HVS, that is cigatoxin associated HVS. One more thing, as I told you, a typical HVS, that is a condition often usually associated with the complement pathway abnormalities. Here there won't be any history of prodromal history of diarrhea dysentery. Typical classical type only, there will be history of 10 to 14 days back, there was the history of diarrhea dysentery. And usually here a typical HVS usually triggered by minor infections like some viral infections like common cold also, and this complement system will be activated. So this answer is usually insidious. And sometimes it may, usually insidious, sometimes it may present rapidly also. But prognosis in a classical HVS is good. They will recover quickly, but typical HVS, the more chances of going into chronic renal failure. So here pathogenesis is microangiopathic lesions, especially affecting the interlobular arteries and results in severe hypertension. So hypertension and progressive renal insufficiency is the main pathological changes due to the microangiopathic changes in the interlobular arteries. Predisposing factors, as I told you, mutations in the regulators of the complementary pathway. A factor H, I, and B, and C3 membrane cofactors are affected. And antibodies against the complementary H factor is also formed in these patients with typical HES. This is the main mechanism, mainly alteration of the alternative pathway complement system. So as I told you, it's a triad of HES is microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia, and acute renal failure. These are the typical three. These three are there, and history of preceding diarrhea, dysentery is there with more chance that say case of hemolytic anemia syndrome. And classically, here you can see microangiopathic changes. This is the capillaries of the glomerulus. Thrombi will be there. These pink ones are the microthrombi in the renal capillaries. Classical HESD plus means diarrhea prodrome present. Classical HESD plus we call it diarrhea prodrome associated with cigar toxin producing O157H7 or O104H4. That is also more commonly associated with classical HES. And most of them will recover. Prognosis will be good in classical HES. Atypical HES as associated with mutations in the complement pathway, poor prognosis, and 50% of the children with atypical HES will go for end-stage renal disease. ESRD means end-stage renal disease, that means chronic renal failure. They need regular dialysis and peritoneal or hemodialysis. So how many days they will continue for that, then they have to go for renal transplantation. In that renal after transplantation also, there may chance of atypical HES again. So that's why it's a poor prognostic. Coming to the clinical features, when will you suspect how they will present? When we will think that this child or this person may be having hemolytic uremic syndrome? As I told you, this may affect any age. Children of all ages will be affected by this hemolytic uremic syndrome. And history of prodrome of acute diarrhea, dysentery, or febrile illness will be there. Especially acute diarrhea and dysentery for typical HES and minor febrile illness for atypical HES. So any HES, any age will be affected, and usual history of prodrome of acute diarrhea or dysentery or febrile illness will be there. And some clinical presentation, sudden onset of pallor. Severe pallor because hemolysis will be expressed. So sudden onset of pallor and oliguria and hypertension. The child usually will be irritable. Sometimes older children, they may complain of headache also. And if it's not diagnosed, if hypertension is not diagnosed not timely and not treated, if you not recognize hypertension, the child may going to develop focal or jealous seizures. That is called as hypertensive encephalopathy. They may present with hypertensive encephalopathy. Sometimes even hypertension in children, especially renal origin, if not treated, they may develop into hypertensive encephalopathy. Heart may be affected. They will go for pulmonary edema and heart failure also. So alteration of consciousness will take place. Coming to the laboratory features or laboratory investigations, most of first and foremost, we have to go for complete blood picture, including blood film. Usually, RBCs in this HES will be, as I told you, it will be broken. And distorted RBC is a typical feature of pathless smear of hemolytic uremic syndrome children. And as hemolysis is there, obviously reticulocyte count will be increased. Any hemolysis, usually reticulocyte count will be increased. These reticulocytes are nothing but premature RBC. So peripherally, blood is destroyed. So bone marrow tries to produce more RBC. So the production of immature RBC, that is reticulocyte count into the reticulocytes into the periphery, leads to increased reticulocyte count. And platelets also destroyed. So thrombocytopenia will be there. And neutrophilic leukocytes, there is a preceding infection with organisms or dysentery. So there will be neutrophilic leukocytosis. And if you go for Coombs test, usually it is negative. Usually HES, Coombs test is negative, but exception is there. That is streptococcus pneumonia associated with HES. This is also entrance bit. If you write down in your notebook, you can go through that. So Coombs test is negative in HES, except in case of streptococcus pneumonia. Other laboratory features are LDH is high in blood levels because of hemolysis, and urine shows microscopic hematuria and there will be mild proteinuria. So typical feature of albuminuria, microscopic hematuria, and mild proteinuria with hypertension is differential diagnosis for acute glomerulonephritis. But other features, what differentiates history of dysentery and diarrhea, and the main peripheral smear examination, RBC, distorted RBC or broken RBC, it won't be there in acute glomerulonephritis. That there is usually history of preceding history of pyoderma, skin lesions will be there in case of post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. So history-wise, we can differentiate between AGN, that is acute glomerulonephritis, usually post-streptococcal, and HVS. Here you can see peripheral smear, a child with HVS. These are the cystocytes. That means broken RBC with sparse. You can see helmet-shaped RBC. All those will be seen in HVS. If this is a picture, you can compare with normal RBC and child with hemolytic uremic syndrome. This is a normal RBC, usually round shaped and concave shape will be there. So because of this biconcave shape, they easily deform while passing the small capillaries. But here in our white cells, these are RBC. These are the they can't deform while passing the capillaries, so leads to clogging at the kidney blood vessels in the kidneys, leading to microthrombi formation. Other features of laboratory features are blood urea and serum creatinine will be rise depending upon the involvement of the renal system. It's mild involvement usually will be normal, but it's severely involved, leading to acute kidney insufficiency. They will rise twofold or threefold like that. Blood urea levels and serum creatinine have to do to all children with HVS. And stool culture we can do, or otherwise you can go for the stool PCR for shigatoxin producing E. coli or ELISA for shigatoxin. Serum complement C3 levels, especially low in atypical type of HVS, especially in some patients with HVS. And detailed analysis of components of alternative complement pathway and its regulators are required if you think it's a typical case like older child, because hello class lo unnandi class tharva chestam hello nen malli chestam detailed analysis of components of the alternative complement pathway and its regulators, especially if you suspect atypical HVS, like in case of child more than 10 years affected, and if you think atypical, they have to go for complete complement analysis, because atypical HVS prognosis will be guarded. As I told you, they're more prone for, more than 50% will go for the chronic renal insufficiency, and they need renal transplantation. And still, if you have suspecting doubtful regarding the diagnosis of HVS, then you have to go for the renal biopsy. That's the endothelial cells are swollen and separated from the basement membrane with accumulation of foamy material in the subendothelial cells. And the capillary lumen is narrowed by swollen endothelial cells, blood vessels, and fibrin. Arterioles show similar changes. Same capillary lumen also will have same features, and renal arterioles. So similar changes like endothelial cells and separation from the basement membrane and accumulation of this foamy material. And there will be patchy or extensive renal cortical necrosis. Renal biopsy is rarely, usually we won't go routinely, but a microscopic hematuria is not subsided, then we have to go for the renal biopsy. Here you can see the renal biopsy with the microthrombi. As I told you, capillaries, because of distorted RBC, they can't deform while passing through the nodules and arterioles to this microthrombin. Yeah, and leads to elastic fibrin thrombin in the glomerular and the interstitial capillaries. This is a microthrombin. here, these are all like. Next, coming to the complications. What really happens if the child develops HUS after a diarrheal episode or dysentery episode? So main commonly affected organisms, organs in the body are gastrointestinal, neurological, brain and kidney. So the gastrointestinal complications like intestinal strictures and perforations will they may develop, and interception that's a surgical emergency, and they may develop pancreatitis and severe abdominal pain they will present, severe colitis. So these are the intestinal complications. And neurological complications are altered mental status, focal muscular signs, and seizures. One more thing called as PRESS. PRESS means posterior reversible encephalitis syndrome. That is due to rise in the blood pressure levels, that's hypertension leading to cerebral edema. That's a condition called as PRESS, posterior reversible encephalitis syndrome. So their child will develop seizures and they will altered sensory syndrome lasting for few weeks, 1 to 2 weeks. Sometimes it may take 1 or 2 months also to recover. So you have to control the BP and reduce the cerebral edema, then only child will become normal. Otherwise, child will have continuous seizures and altered sensory. Next is the renal system. As I told, it's most commonly affected organ, followed by brain and GIT. They may develop acute renal failure, not treated. It may go for chronic renal failure, and hematuria, hypertension, and proteinuria. Next, coming to the differential diagnosis. It may mean with acute abdomen, as I told you, it may be due to interstitial or pancreatitis or ulcers and perforation. The child may develop pain abdomen. So acute abdomen, like we have to exclude the acute appendicitis and other causes of acute abdomen before diagnosing hemolytic uremic syndrome. And they may mimic acute gastroenteritis because of loose stools, and also blood and mucus in the stools, and they will have colitis. Usually that also they will present with pain abdomen, especially lower left lower tenesmus, and with fever. This is a severe abdominal pain they will present with colitis. And disseminated intravascular coagulation because of thrombocytopenia, and inflammatory bowel disease like Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. It mimics like because of lower abdominal pain and bloody stools, and lupus, systemic lupus erythematosus, multi-system involvement because renal system involved, GIT involved, brain, neurological involvement. You may have to exclude lupus, systemic lupus erythematosus, but there will be other features of systemic lupus erythematosus like skin rash and other features will be there, oral ulcers. All those we have to clinically differentiate, and thrombotic thrombocytopenia. So these are the differential diagnosis we have to explored before labeling as hemolytic uremic syndrome clinically. Next, coming to the treatment, how we will treat hemolytic uremic syndrome. Treatment includes management of complications, especially of renal failure like capricornia, have to treat. Anuria will be there, you have to give fluids cautiously, and you have to take care of the diet of the child. Treatment of hypertension, very, very important. If you won't treat hypertension, as I told you, the child may going to develop PRESS, that is posterior reversible encephalitis syndrome, where there will be cerebral edema formation and leading to continuous seizures and altered sensory. And also heart, like left ventricular failure and pulmonary edema, they develop if you won't treat the hypertension. If you treat, usually it's transient, it won't be permanent, unless the child goes for end-stage renal disease. And correction of anemia. So depending on HB levels, we have less than 5 plan for blood transmission. But HB is less. And proper nutrition, as I told you, because the catabolic state child needs more calories. So you have to give calorie dense, but proteins cautiously you have to give. And fluids also, depending on the renal output, urine output only, you have to adjust the fluid intake also. And the child may need, if there is renal insufficiency, you have to go for peritoneal dialysis and hemodialysis. Still, if it is not recovered, renal function is not recovered after 4 to 6 weeks, then you have to plan for the renal transplantation. Other modalities, repeated plasma exchange with infusion of fresh frozen plasma. These are the other modalities. Because especially antibodies produced against the complement will be removed if you do plasma exchange. And immunosuppressive drugs like cytotoxic drugs, we can use to reduce the antibody production against the complements, especially against the H component of the complement. And there are recently monoclonal antibodies targeted against the C5, that is eculizumab. Eculizumab, there is a drug, it's a monoclonal antibody targeted against this complement component C5. So these are the recent modalities and other alternative modalities of treatment of hemolytic uremic syndrome. So like these monoclonal antibodies will act and that RBC coated with antibodies to the complement and reduce the destruction of RBC and platelets. Coming to the prognosis, usually whenever you diagnose one condition, obviously parents will be anxious about the prognosis of the condition. They will ask you, what happens to my child? Is it will be okay now, or it will be any chronic sequel and all those things. So here actually HES associated with mortality is very low. Especially if it's a typical condition, classical Shiga toxin associated HES mortality during acute episodes is very low. But unfortunately, there may be 20 to 30% of patients may develop residual DNA damage. That is for classical. In case of a typical, more than 50% will develop renal damage, residual renal damage. That is end-stage renal syndrome. Factors suggest about poor prognosis. Here you have to remember this one. What are the factors which indicates poor prognosis? If the oliguria and anuria for more than 2 weeks, so the urine output, actually when you call oliguria, the child urine output per hour is less than 0.6 ml per kg per hour. Less than 0.6 ml per kg per hour, less than 0.5 ml per kg per hour for more than 6 hours, we call as oliguria. If it is lasting for more like that, for more than 2 weeks, the child may be having poor prognosis. Severe nodal loss can involve like seizures and altered sensation. Presence of cortical necrosis. So these are prognostic features in renal biopsy. Presence of cortical necrosis in the renal biopsy. So these three features are indicates poor prognosis. Next, coming to the other factors which affects the acute and long-term outcome in atypical HES, as I told you, always unsatisfactory. You have to remember, in case of classical, it's only 20 to 30% will develop into end-stage renal disease. But in case of atypical HES, where it's due to complement alteration in the complement system, abnormal activation of complement system, prognosis will be more than 50% of the children going for chronic renal disease. And recurrent episodes of hemolytic uremic syndrome occur in these children with atypical HES because of, as I told you, it's inherited problem, not acquired due to some thing like classical HES, where dysentery or diarrhea alters the by production of toxin, it alters the endothelium. But here it's due to altered complement activation system, which is the cause for the destruction of RBC and microvasculature. So these children will have recurrent episodes, and even after transplantation also, in that transplant kidney also, they are going to develop hemolytic uremic syndrome. Coming to the prevention, once you know this prognosis, almost if the child, more than 50% are going for end-stage renal disease, it's better to prevent the hemolytic uremic syndrome in children than to diagnose and treat. So how will you prevent it? So mainly hygienic precautions, like organisms are very common in, as I told you, it's a non-human mammals will carry this and glycoryl neuraminic acid, sialic acid. So that is more common. So in cattle and other things, non-vegetarian food, while preparing, processing, and slaughtering, they should take care of prevention of fecal contamination during slaughtering and processing. And good personal hygiene, like hand washing before and after handling the meat or other food stuff, and before eating and after toilet use, and all those general precautions, hygienic precautions should be there. And after contact with the farm animals also, they should wash their hands. And especially public awareness is more important about the good food hygiene. Especially you should not mix the raw meat and cooked meat and meat products, especially where this burgers and all those things people will eat. Those things, they should have good hygienic precautions. Avoid cross-contamination between raw and food. That's very, very important to prevent dysenteries. And all those precautions, public health precautions, have to advise to the parents and children, especially hand hygiene, you have to advise, and avoiding partially cooked and uncooked food, eating uncooked or partially cooked food. Early diagnosis enables early supportive treatment and better ultimate prognosis. As I told you, early identification of outbreaks, especially if some area the outbreak is there. So there, public health people has to go and check where is the source of the contamination, like any hotels are maybe where they are by getting the meat and all those areas maybe there. So they have to go to slaughterhouse and they have to see how they are doing. And especially whenever there is epidemics, separating known cases from their younger siblings. It's very, very appropriate because as I told you, younger the age, there are more chance of getting immunity. And there are trials for E. coli vaccination, conjugate vaccines against E. coli 157 in development phase 3. So they are just one more phase, they can get the vaccines, conjugate vaccines against E. coli, which can be associated with the immunity syndrome. So these are the preventive measures all of you should know, and you have to, whenever you're going for the field, like community medicine will be going for field work, we will write case sheets as for the acute ARL disease or acute ARL dysentery. How to prevent those, we have to know, and you have to educate the parents. So any doubts regarding definition, types and pathogenesis and clinical features? Any doubts? Ask you for usually they will ask 4 marks question and 2 marks question, mainly quiz and also PG entrance. Sometimes, especially in general medicine, you may get as a say 10 marks question. So, but you know, it's a one entity is there, cumulative epidemic syndrome, usually preceded by history of diarrhea, dysentery. Commonest species associated with cumulative epidemic syndrome is the E. coli 1O157 and H7 and 104 and H4, Shigella, dysentery type. These are the commonest organisms, but other organisms which can cause dysentery also associated with hemolytic uremic syndrome, like streptococcus pneumonia. That's a classical typical HUS. There is a one atypical HUS that is due to abnormal activation of alternate pathway of complement. Any doubts? Jyoti Prakash. CR Jyoti Prakash kada, is CR name is Jyoti Prakash or not? Any doubts are there? Any doubts? Jyoti Prakash, Devendra, if you are not having any doubts, I will end the meeting. Doubts are there or not? Any doubts? Anybody want to ask anything regarding diarrheal diseases or dysentery or hemolytic uremic syndrome? Not only about this topic, as I told you, it's one of the complications of diarrhea and dysentery. You can ask me anything regarding diarrhea, dysentery or hemolytic uremic syndrome. Any doubts are there or not?
No, ma'am.
Okay. No doubts? Okay then. I will end the meeting, okay?